So in this lecture, I'll be talking about the architecture of artificial neural network. So in the last lecture, we have discussed about the model of an artificial neuron. What are the different components of artificial neuron? And we have seen that this artificial neuron is having a serious resemblance with a biological neuron. Now, in general, we can consider three different architectures of any neural network, three fundamental classes, as it is called. The first one is known as the single-layered feed-forward architecture. Then we have the multi-layered feed-forward architecture, and then ultimately the recurrent network architecture. So in general, the class of ANN architecture can be classified into these three categories. Now, before we talk about the first one, that is single layered feed forward architecture, let us try to have some understanding whether a single neuron can perform any action on its own or not. That means, without the use of any architecture, as you know, if I connect the number of neurons in different fashion, following some guidelines, following some rule, then it gives us a particular architecture. Now, before investigating anything on the architecture, isn't it possible for a single neuron to do any action? Or in other words, we are trying to emphasize, or we are trying to identify the simplest action which may be performed by a single neuron. Then ultimately, when these neurons are connected in a grid fashion or so, then we can understand, we can appreciate what could have been the collective action being taken by all those neurons in a network. Now, to start with, let us take a particular problem of Boolean AND operation. Hopefully, all of you are well aware of Boolean AND operation. Considering two input variables, x1 and x2, which are binary inputs, so we can have four different possible input combination like 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. And correspondingly, the outputs are like 0, 0, 0, and 1. So the condition is, if both the input is equal to 1, then the output will be 1. As we know from our basic understanding in Boolean logic. Now the question is, we know that that can be easily implemented by using the IC chip nowadays. And before that, we can use transistors to realize this type of AND function, AND gates. So as far as the progress in electronics is concerned, there are different logics, RTL, DTL, TTL. Now we have CMOS logic. We have the IC chips, which can successfully implement this particular AND operation. Not only this operation, but also all the Boolean operations. So this can be done by means of some electronic chip. But the question here is whether the same operation, this AND operation, can be implemented, can be realized, can be trained to an artificial neuron or not. If yes, then one can say that the artificial neuron, a single neuron, is capable enough to successfully implement the idea of AND function. Now, how can we say that, okay, that particular neuron has successfully implemented this function? So to understand this, we have to provide a set of inputs to the system, to the neuron, and we need to check whether the corresponding output is being obtained from the neuron or not. So if you can recall the architecture of a single neuron, I mean the model of a single neuron, artificial neuron. So we do have a number of inputs which are connected to the dendrites by means of some weights like W1, W2, and so on. These are then summed up together and a nonlinear function is there. Might be a threshold function so that the output is obtained. So here, since we have two inputs like x1 and x2, so it will make our task easier. So we have two inputs, x1 and x2. And accordingly, the output is also given. So this is nothing but the training pattern. And this is exhaustive. The list is exhaustive. Why exhaustive? Because we know that if x1 and x2, these are the two binary inputs, so they can have altogether four different possibilities. 00011011. So there is no issue of testing. So if you train the system by means of these four patterns for a two input AND gate, the list is exhaustive. There is no other input possible for a two input AND gate. But still, considering this as a fundamental problem, people have initially thought that, okay, let us have a look whether this particular problem and the corresponding solution can be implemented, can be realized by any artificial neuron or not. So the set of input and output is given. So what you need to do, going back to the machine learning technology, we have to set the program. So what is the program we're talking about here? So as far as the architecture of neuron is concerned, we have to identify the weights because these are the unknown things. We know x1, we know x2, we know the corresponding output y. All that I need to find out is the corresponding weights and the threshold function and the threshold value. So nonlinear function, I have to identify, and the threshold value. So looking at the output pattern, since we are dealing with a Boolean operation, Boolean AND operation, so there could have been two different possible outputs, either 0 or 1. So it can be anticipated that the function which you use to replicate the synaptic region is obviously a hard limiting function. We don't require this log sigmoid function or tan sigmoid function, because for those functions which are continuous in nature, where the output is also continuous. Here the output is discrete. Output can assume only two values like 0 and 1 because it's a binary variable. So first of all, you have to identify what should be the corresponding nonlinear function. Is it a hard limiting function or soft limiting function? So the problem says that, the problem dictates that you require a hard limiting function. And truly speaking, a step function, not a signum function. Because for signum function, we have plus 1, minus 1. Now, since the output is 0 and 1, so we can use simple step function. So one problem is solved. Then what about the weights and what about the threshold value? So the AND problem, as I mentioned, so AND problem can be thought of as a perceptron problem, where we have to receive the four different inputs and corresponding the outputs are given. So as I am talking about, so this has been represented pictorially. For this rate combination 00100001, the output will be 0, and for input 1, 1, the output will be 1. So x1, x2 is given, y is also given. So this is the training set, an exhaustive training set. All you need to do is to find out W1 and W2 and the corresponding threshold value over here. Let us just consider this, for instance, this single neuron. So X1 and X2, these are the two inputs, and they have considered the corresponding weights to be 0.5 and 0.5 each. And the corresponding threshold value is equal to 0.9. Then what happens? The output Y can be written like summation Wi Xi. So we have W1 X1 plus W2 X2 minus theta, because theta is the threshold here. And assume that both W and W2 is equal to 0.5, which is equal to 0.9. Now what happens if both the input is equal to 0? Let us check whether you are getting the same output or not. If both the input is equal to 0, so summation WXI will be 0 with minus theta. Theta will be 0.9, so minus 0.9. So since it is less than 0, so obviously the output will be 0. Next, let us consider one of the input is 0, either X1 is 0 or X2 is 0. So the other input is 1, so it is multiplied with 0.5, so it will give you 0.5. 0.5 minus 0.9, so the result is negative, minus 0.4. So the step function will give an output of 0. So for the first three cases, when one of the input is equal to 0, the output will be 0. What about the last case? For the last case, when both the input is equal to 1, the output will be 0.5 into 1 plus 0.5 into 1, that is 1, minus 0.9, that is 0.1, which is greater than 0. So the step function will decide the value of 1. So by selecting these weights, W1 to be 0.5 and W2 to be 0.5 and theta to be 0.9, the single neuron is capable enough to replicate the operation of an AND function. So this is the property, this is the attribute or operation of a single neuron. However, although the situation is very easy for an AND function, but later on we will see that it is not possible for a single neuron to realize any arbitrary Boolean function. For example, instead of AND function, if the function is a XOR function or exclusive OR function, then it will not be possible for a single neuron to replicate the operation, identify the operation. It might be true for AND function or OR function to some extent. But for the XOR function, which is exclusive OR, it is not possible, irrespective of the value of weights and the threshold you select. You can go with any arbitrary value of weights and the threshold value, theta. But you never find that a single neuron is capable enough, single artificial neuron is capable enough to realize the XOR function. However, to start with, what we can ensure is simple function like AND, simple Boolean function like AND may be realized by means of a neuron. Moreover, it is not true only for a single two input AND. Even if you increase the number of input, like say three input AND or four input AND, then also it is possible for a single neuron to realize the AND function. Now, once you get the single neuron, then let us try to understand what is meant by the single layer fit for our neural network. So we have already understood the capacity or capability of a single neuron. Now, when these neurons are present in this particular fashion, consisting of creating a layer of neurons like this, This is known as a single layer feed forward neural network. So you have to understand the meaning of each of the terms. What do you mean by single layer? So those neurons, suppose there are n number of neurons. So this n number of neurons, they are forming a particular layer, a single layer. Only one layer is there. And this gives rise to the first architecture of the artificial neural network. First architecture we talk about, the single layer fit forward neural network. We have multi-layer and we have the recurrent structure. The single layer means we have a single, only one layer of neurons. How many neurons? So that depends upon the complexity of the problem, or depends on the complexity of the system itself. So we can take n number of such neurons, and each of the neurons might be identical in nature or might be different. However, the basic blocks are the same. We have a summation, we have a nonlinear operation over here, because this will resemble the operation of a cell body and the synapse. But however, the synaptic function may be different, as identified in this particular slide. The synaptic function for this neuron, so this is the first neuron identified by this blue box, blue circle. The synaptic function is F1, corresponding to the first neuron. For this one, the synaptic function is F2, for this one is F3, and so on. So either you can have the same synaptic function F, or you could have different types of synaptic function, F1, F2, F3, and so on. The summer block will be as it is. Then what about the input? So although we have n number of such neurons, now previously what we have understood, the number of neurons here is equal to n, and the number of inputs for a particular neuron, suppose let us model the number of inputs for a particular neuron to be m, and the value of m might be equal to n or might not be equal to n. So here intentionally the value of m is not equal to n. Suppose n is equal to 10 and m is equal to say 7. So each of the neurons, they will accept 7 such inputs. X1, X2, X3, X4, X5, X6, X7. So all those 7 inputs will be fed to the first neuron, to the second neuron, to the third neuron, and so on. So the number of inputs has nothing to do with the number of neurons. Number of inputs might be more, might be less, or sometimes it might also be equal to the number of neurons. Each neuron will accept a set of inputs, 1, 2, 3, up to n. And the way the outputs, I mean, this I1, I2, I3 are generated, which is nothing but the output of the dendrons and input to the cell body. So it will vary. It will vary depending upon the weights, because all the neurons are getting the same input, X1, X2, X3, up to XM. But the corresponding weights are different. For the first neuron, the weights are W11, W12, W13, up to W1M. What is W11? W11 is the weight connection between the input 1 and the neuron 1. W12, weight connection between the input 2 and the neuron 1. Or I can say neuron 1 and input 2. And W13, neuron 1, unit 3, and so on. For the second neuron, the corresponding inputs are, for example, say W21, W22, W23, up to W2M. For the third neuron, W31, W32, and so on. So this I1, I2, I3 will be different. So the I1, I2, I3, IN, they are different. And the corresponding outputs O1, O2, O3, ON, they will also depend upon the value of this I1, I2, I3, IN, and the corresponding F function, that is F1, F2, F3, and FN. So this is for a single layer feed forward neural network. Now, why is it called a feed forward? Because if I just consider the corresponding weights or the propagation of signals, so the propagation of signal is following the forward node always. That means the signal propagation takes place from this point to this point, from this input to this neuron. So if I just take a look at the arrow associated with each of the weights, so signal will propagate in this direction from input to neuron, from input to neuron. And if I have a multilayer kind of thing, then the propagation of signal will be from this side to this side, from input side to the output side. And that is the notion of feed-forward architecture. Everywhere in electrical, in control system, we have the concept of this feed-forward and feedback. So feed-forward means the signal will propagate from the input to the output. So the entire architecture, I mean, if I just consider the weights over here, so depending upon the number of inputs and the number of neurons present over here, we can model this set of weights by means of a matrix. And this matrix is known as weight matrix. So the first row is nothing but W1, W12, W13, W1n, which are nothing but the weights associated with the first neuron, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, up to 1n. Second row corresponds to W21, W22, W22n, which are nothing but the weights connected between the inputs and the second neuron. And similarly, all the weights are modeled by means of this weight matrix when the inputs are identified by x1, x2, up to xn. So for any kth neuron, one can write the corresponding output by means of this particular function. For the kth neuron, we need to take into account all the inputs xi from I is equal to 1 to m. If there are m number of such inputs, so wik xi summation I is equal to 1 to m, and one can write plus theta k or minus theta k, doesn't matter depending upon the signature. I mean, if I consider the signature value of this theta k to be positive enough, so in that case you have to place a positive sign. And if I consider the corresponding value, I mean, if I just consider the magnitude only, in that case, you have to put a minus sign. That means intentionally, if I consider that theta k will be negative, so I can simply write plus of theta k. Or you can also write like minus or mod theta k. It will not make any difference. So this is the threshold value. And for each of the neurons, the corresponding functions are different. So that's fk, f of k. So nonlinear function is not the same. So f of k. Then within the argument, we have this one. I called 1 to m, wi kxi plus theta k. Now this type of network is feed forward in type or acyclic in nature. And therefore the name is single layer feed forward network. Then comes the next type of neural network, which is known as the multilayered feedforward neural network. So there is only one change with respect to the single layered feedforward neural network. Now, instead of having a single layer, now we have a set of layers. So for a single layer, the neurons were arranged just like a vector. It was arranged just like a vector. If I consider this one, it was arranged like a vector. Suppose a column vector over here, because it is a single layer. Now, if I consider a multi-layered feed-forward neural network, so we should have a number of layers, multiple number of layers. So one layer, then another layer, and so on. And in which case, we can model those neurons by means of a matrix. Now, out of these different layers, if I have more than two layers, the first layer is known as the input layer, and the last layer is known as the output layer. And in between the input layer and output layer, we may be having a number of hidden layers. And these hidden layers can perform different actions. A number of intermediary computation can be done within this hidden layer, and which are present in between the input and the output layer. So if you can remember the face recognition application, which we have discussed in the first lecture on machine learning, perhaps you can remember that there were a number of layers identified by different planes, say plane number one, plane number two, plane number three, and so on. And the input to the entire system, to the entire network, was a human face. And from each layer, by means of some algorithm, by judiciously selecting the weight value, W, we can ultimately find out different computations. So for example, as far as I can remember, from a particular layer, the age information was extracted. From another layer, some important feature associated with the object or object information is extracted. And ultimately, the pattern class is obtained in the last layer. So each of these hidden layers, so they will perform some intermediary actions. Some computation is being done. And ultimately, the overall output is the combination of each of the outputs which are computed internally. So there is a notion of representation for this multi-layered feed-forward neural network. And as the name is feed-forward, so you must understand that the signal will be propagated from the input side to the output side. There is no feedback signal from the output to the input. So notionally, it can be represented like this: L, M1, M2, MP, N. What is the meaning of that? We have started with L number of input neurons. That means the number of neurons in the first layer. So in case of single layer, we have a, say, N neurons here. So this is the first layer for a multi-layer feedback network, feed-forward network. So this is the first layer consisting of L neurons. Then the number of neurons in the hidden layer, they are represented by M1, M2, up to MP. So L dash M1 dash M2 dash MP. And finally, there are N neurons at the last layer. And this is the architecture, this is the notion by means of which it is being represented. So just take a look at this particular architecture, which is for multi-layer feed-forward neural network. So we have, say, initially we have p number of inputs, x1, x2, up to xp. First layer of neurons is identified by blue. Second layer of neurons is identified by red. And third layer of neurons is identified by green. So there could have been a number of hidden layers. But this is the input layer, identified by blue. We have different activation function, F11, F12, F11, FL1. Then we have F21, F22, up to F2M. And F31, F32, up to F3M. So different activation function associated with different neurons. And the weight connections are exhaustive. That is very important. Here, we have already discussed in case of single layer feed-forward network, all the inputs are being provided to the neurons. Because each of the inputs, so they possess some characteristics, some attributes. And we need to train each of the neurons with all of the attributes. So that's why the connection is very much exhaustive. So here, if I have p number of input, I mean, if the input signal is p dimensional, so you have a data that can be regarded as capital X as a vector, and the points within the vector, like x1, x2, x3, they identify different characteristics. So this x1 to xp, they are being fed to all the neurons, like first neuron, second neuron, third neuron in the first layer. Then the output is computed over here, summation wixi. These are the w's, and each of the w's are different, and that can be modeled by means of a matrix. We have p neurons, we have l neurons and p inputs. So it will be a matrix of l cross p, or p cross l, the way you try to formulate. Then the output is computed here, output of the cell body or soma, and then depending upon the corresponding nonlinear function, the output of the neuron is obtained over here. Then the output of this neuron in the first layer, the first neuron in the first layer, it will be shared with all the neurons in the next layer. So that's why there is a connection, exhaustive connection, from this neuron to this neuron, this neuron to this neuron, and so on. And that is true for all the neurons. So the connection is exhaustive. And that's why it is known to be a robust connection. Robust connection and fault tolerant connection. As I've already mentioned that if there is certain problem associated with some of the neurons, now since the output has been shared with many of the neurons, in fact, all of the neurons, output of layer number L is being shared with the inputs or with the neurons of all the neurons of the next layer, that is L plus one. So if this is the, suppose I am considering a particular layer over here, a hidden layer, say let the layer be represented by H, then for all the neurons in layer number H, it will be shared, the output of all the neurons in layer number H will be shared with the neurons which are present at layer number H plus 1. And ultimately, from the last layer, the output will be obtained, O1, O2, up to On, if there are n number of such neurons in the last layer. So this is a kind of exhaustive connection, which makes it robust. And what about the recurrent neural network architecture? So in case of recurrent neural network architecture, we have a feedback loop. So at least one feedback loop has to be there. So therefore, we can say that for a recurrent network, the notion of multilayer or single layer may not be that useful. There could exist only one layer with feedback connection. Then also I can say that it's a kind of recurrent network, recurrent neural network architecture. So if we have neurons with self-feedback links, that means the output of a neuron is fed back to its input. Then also it is known as a recurrent connection. So we have the possibility to obtain a recurrent single layer neural network architecture or recurrent multi-layer architecture? The only thing is that you have to ensure at least one feedback loop, so that depending upon the performance of any particular neuron, it can auto adjust its parameters so as to take a better action next time. So feedback is always essential in any of the electronic circuits or electrical circuit to make the stability better. And the same notion is also used here while formulating the recurrent neural network architecture. So for example, this can be regarded as a recurrent network, recurrent neural network. So although it has been shown with a number of layers, 3 layers for example, now here we have a recurrent connection, a feedback connection from this point to that point. The output of this neuron is also fed back as an input, one of the inputs of this neuron. Then the output of the last neuron, the output of one of the neurons in the last layer is being fed back to one of the neurons in the first layer. And output of one of the neurons in the last layer is being fed back to the one of the inputs of a neuron in the hidden layer. So depending upon the different types of feedback loops, several recurrent neural network models are existing. So we have a Hopfield network, we have Boltzmann machine network, and so on. Now this question, why different types of neural network architecture? Is it not possible to have a single network architecture which can solve all the purpose? Now let us try to find out the answer of this question using a simple network model. So here we have a single neuron. So the F function can be written like W1X1 plus W2X2 plus some B0. So B0 can be regarded as a threshold function, as threshold value. So if X1 and X2, these are the two inputs, so the corresponding output of a cell body is given by W1X1 plus W2X2 plus some B0. So you can write plus B0 or minus B0. It doesn't make any sense, doesn't make any change in practice, because it depends upon the formulation of the function that we use as a synaptic function. So what we have? We have F is equal to W1X1 plus W2X2 plus some constant. So constant may be positive or negative. Now, on a two-dimensional axis like X1 and X2, this will represent a straight line. 3X plus 4Y is equal to 5, for example. 3X plus 4Y equal to 5, this is nothing but an equation of straight line. AX plus BY equal to C on a 2D scale. So what a typical neuron can do? A typical neuron can segregate a two-dimensional space into two different classes by means of a straight line. As far as the property of the cell body and the synaptic region is concerned, it will perform a straight line division, a linear separation, what is called in literature, straight line separation. So we have also seen the idea of straight line separation while discussing about the classifier in one of the lectures, support vector machine classifier. So if I have a two-dimensional data like X1 and X2, so then in order to segregate them into two different classes, I need a straight line. If I have a one-dimensional data like X1 only, to segregate them into two different classes, I need a point, that is threshold. Then from one to two dimension, I need a straight line to segregate the data in a two-dimensional axis. If I want to segregate three-dimensional data, then that can be done using a plane and so on. So we have discussed this notion in some of the previous lectures. So straight line separation, linear separation is possible using a single neuron. Now, if the value of the data point is above the straight line, we will decide that it is in class 1. And if it is below the straight line, we will decide that it is in class 0. So for a single neural network or single neuron, this function f is equal to v0 plus w1x1 plus w2x2, it denotes a straight line in the plane on x1, x2. So depending upon the value of x1 and x2 and w1 and w2, we have to decide whether this is in class 0 or in class 1. And accordingly, we can say that these points are known as linearly separable. If the straight line can actually separate them into two different classes. Now let us consider these two situations. Suppose this is one set of data points, this shape, and this is another shape. Now, as you can understand, if I can draw a straight line like this, then it can successfully segregate these data points from these data points. That means they are linearly separable. So we can have a linear equation, a straight line equation, which can segregate them into two different classes. On the other hand, let us consider a situation like this. One cannot draw a straight line which can segregate. Suppose this is one, this particular thing, this is one structure, I mean, set of data points, and this is another set of data points over here. So one cannot draw a straight line which can segregate them into two different classes. No matter which way you try it, you may change the slope, you may change the value of c and all, y is equal to mx plus c to change the straight line equation. You can do several actions, change the slope, change the intercept and all, but you will not be able to do that. So for the first case, this one is known as, these data points are known as linearly separable. However, these data points are non-linearly separable or linearly non-separable. If you can draw a curved line which goes like this, then it is possible for you to segregate them into two different classes. But otherwise, it is not at all possible. Now let us consider the AND or XOR problem, which we have just now discussed. What was the AND problem? We know already. Both the inputs are 0, output 0. One input 0, another input 1, output 0. Both the inputs are 1, output 1. What will be the XOR output? For XOR, if one of the input is 1, then the output is 1. And if both of them are same, then the output will be 0. So for 0, 0 and 1, 1, the output will be 0, and 0, 1 and 1, 0, the output will be 1. So that is the XOR problem, unlike the AND problem. Now, already we have seen that AND problem was successfully handled by a single neural network. Now, let us check whether it is possible for XOR problem also or not. Now, to answer this question, let us try to understand, or let us try to figure out the points. So for AND gate, so these are the two variables. Along the horizontal, we have x1. Along the vertical, we have x2. So this is the 0 point, 0, 0. This is 0, 1, this point. This is 1, 0, and this is 1, 1. So just by observing the output, you understand that this 0, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 0, these set of inputs, they form a class, because for them, the output is 0. And this 1, 1, they will form another class. That means the output is 1 here. So these three points, 0, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 0, they will form a class. These three data points, they will form a class. And 1, 1, they will form, it will form another class. So now you have these three points in one side, and this point is another side. You can easily draw a straight line like this, which can segregate these data points, these four data points, into two classes. These three on one side and this one on the other side. Now, during that discussion, I have also told you that it is also possible not only for the AND gate, but also for the OR gate. You know, for the OR gate, if both the input is equal to 0, then the output is 0. And otherwise, if one of the input is 1, then the output is 1. So if I consider those four points, data points, once again, for the OR problem, Boolean OR function, then these three points, these 0, 1, 1, 1, and 1, 0, they will form a class, because for them the output is 1. And this 0, 0 will form another class, because for them the output is different, that is 0. So once again, you can easily segregate these four points into two classes just by shifting this straight line little bit in this direction. If you draw a straight line between these two points like this, then obviously the 0, 0 will be on one side, and 1, 1, 1, 0, and 0 will be on the other side. So only the intercept will be different. So from our knowledge in coordinate geometry, we know that in this way, our representation of a straight line can be written like x by a plus y by b is equal to 1. Now here, both a and b, the intercept in the along the x-axis and along the y-axis, it is higher than 1, as you find it out. 0.9 by 0.5, that is the value, higher than 1. But to classify for an OR problem, the corresponding value of intercept should be less than 1, because now the straight line should be this one. So it is in between 0 and 1. So accordingly, it is possible. So only thing you need to do is that you have to change the corresponding weights and the threshold value. So both the AND and OR problem is linearly separable. Now, as long as it is linearly separable, we can use a simple neuron, a single neuron, in fact, to do this purpose, to do this action. Now, what happens for the XOR problem? For XOR problem, we also have these four points, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. But for 0, 0, and 1, 1, the output is same, that is 0. And for 0, 1, and 1, 0, the output is same. So the points lying diagonally, so they will form a class. So this point and this point, they will form a class. And this point, they will form another class. So can you draw a single straight line which can segregate them into two different classes? So if I draw like this, if I draw like this, suppose this straight line, like this, then apart from these two, this is also included, which is a misclassification. So if you draw a straight line like this, what happens? Apart from these two, this is also included. Another instance of misclassification. So it is not possible to draw a single straight line which can segregate these four data points into two different classes. Last time, for both AND and OR problem, out of four data points, three were put in one side and the rest one was put in the other side. But this time, it is evenly distributed, two in one side and two on the other side. So this XOR problem is linearly non-separable problem. I cannot draw a single straight line which can linearly separate them. So what is the solution? Solution is that, okay, yes, we can do that. We can perform the same action using the neuron, artificial neuron, but that cannot be solved using a single neuron. Let us try to understand that. If I put, or if I draw two straight lines like this, that means one straight line
like this, which we have drawn for AND function. And the other straight line, like this, we have drawn for the OR function. So if I draw two straight lines like this, then it is possible for me to segregate them into two different classes. So the points which are lying inside those two straight lines, they will be in one class. So if I draw a straight line like this, and another straight line like this, so they will be, so these two points will be under the, within these two straight lines, inside the straight lines. And the rest two points, 0, 0 and 1, 1, they will be outside. So it is possible to equivalently represent linearly non-separable problems as a combination of two linearly separable problems. So I need to draw two straight, I need to devise two straight lines, one for the AND function and the other for the OR function. And then their combined effect will give me the notion of linearly non-separable function. So therefore, as I've already mentioned, for a two classification problem, it acts as a decision boundary, then we can say that such problem is linearly separable. So otherwise non-linearly separable. And that is also true for n classification problem. It's a two classification problem because we have considered only two such classes, 0 and 1. Now it is also possible for n classification problem if we have the n dimensional space, then the boundary would be n minus 1 dimensions. And we have already discussed this notion during our discussion in classification. If I have a single dimensional data, like the mass of any rat, and if I would like to classify the rats on the basis of their masses, so mass is only one variable, single dimensional. So one can classify the rats on the basis of their mass by using a threshold value, which is a scalar quantity. So it's a point. Higher than the threshold in one class, lower than threshold in another class. It's a point. So point means zero dimensional. Then if I have two such data, like say age and the weight of the mouse, then it is possible to segregate them into two different classes, classify them into two different classes by means of any classifier. And here, the classifier will be like a straight line. Similarly, if I have three different attributes like age, height, and weight, for example, then accordingly that can be done using a plane. So generally, I can say that if the problem can be represented by an n-dimensional space, then the boundary would be n minus 1 dimensions that separates a given set. For linearly separable problems, you have already seen that single layer feedforward neural network is good enough. A single neuron, that means the AND problem. But for the non-linearly separable problem, we cannot do it using a single layered neural network. So what has to be done? I require a multi-layer feed-forward neural network. So in one layer, one operation will be done because we have the notion of AND and OR to be taken together to ultimately realize what is the XOR function. So to solve such a problem, multi-layer feed-forward neural network is needed. So that is the basic idea behind the development of different types of architecture pertaining to the neural network. So one particular architecture may not be able to give solution for any type of problem. For example, if I consider this XOR problem once again, so the same set of inputs X1 and X2 over here, and let's consider the corresponding weights are 1 and 1 here, so all the weights are 1. So this is for a single, so this is these two neurons with the threshold value of 0.5 and 1.5, they are in one layer, the first layer. And we require another neuron in the next layer, that is the second layer. And since the output is binary, so either you have to decide in favor of 0 or 1. So in the output side, it can be done using a single neuron only, because a single neuron can produce two outputs, either 0 or 1. So output is a scalar quantity. So a single neuron is needed. From where this neuron is getting the output input? From the output of the previous two neurons, the neurons which are present in the previous layers. Now suppose that both the inputs are 0. Now if both the inputs are 0 here, so we have a 0 value over here, the summation will be 0. And if I assume that we have a threshold value of 0.5, so 0 minus 0.5, it will give us minus 0.5. So ultimately, the output will be 0 from that particular neuron. And this is being fed over here. Similarly, here also, if it is 1.5, so both of the inputs are 0, you have 1.5, so once again negative. So we have minus 1 over here, so 0 into minus 1, so once again 0. So here the total combination is equal to 0. And it has to be compared with this threshold, and the output will be accordingly developed. Similarly, both the inputs are 1. If both the inputs are 1, then also you'll find that a similar type of output will be developed. And this output is also 0. However, if one of the input is 1 and the other input is 0, then you'll find that here the contribution will be 1 minus 0.5, because 1 into 1 plus 1 into 0, so 1 minus 0.5, that is 0.5. So 0.5 will give us 1. This output will be 1. So this 1 is multiplied with 1, so another 1. And from this side, we have 0. Because we have a minus sign over here, minus 1 and 1.5 here. So even if it is 1, one of the input is 0, one of the input is 1. So the output will be, so the input to the cell body will be 1 only. So 1 minus 1.5. So the result is minus 0.5. So minus 0.5 will give us 0. So 0 into minus 1 will be 0. So here we have already 1. So 1 is greater than. So if I have a multi-layered kind of connection like this, we can easily solve the XOR problem. So depending upon the problem definition, if it moves from AND to XOR, that cannot be solved using a single neuron. I require 3 such neurons with different threshold value, with different weights, and they are arranged in 2 different layers, first layer and second layer. So apart from the static neural network, sometimes the output needs to be compared with the target value continuously to find out the error signal. And in which case, it is known as a dynamic neural network. So depending upon the category of applications, so we may consider 2 different types of neural networks. One is known as a static neural network, and the second one is known as a dynamic neural network. For static neural network, the error is never calculated, and accordingly, no feedback is being provided to the neural network for updating the weights. So the static neural networks will essentially be slow learners in realizing any particular input output pattern. Now, on the other hand, if I consider dynamic neural network for which the weights are adapted continuously depending upon the error value. So these dynamic neural networks can be considered to be fast learner, because the difference between the actual output and the desired output or target output is always computed. And accordingly, depending upon the difference, the weights are adapted. Either the weights are adapted, or sometimes both the weight and the architecture are also. Both of them are adapted, so that very quickly the system or the neural network tunes to the input output pattern. This is the notion of dynamic neural network. And in the next lecture, I'll be talking about how to learn or how to impose the concept of learning on those neural network model so that they can be properly trained. So there are different learning algorithms. So we will be discussing each of the algorithms very briefly. So this particular slide is for a dynamic neural network. So we have the inputs. So input has been modeled by means of black box. So this is the neural network architecture where this feed forward kind or feedback kind of things, or in fact the feed forward kind of network has been implemented here, and the feedback has been provided from the outside. So we can have a single layer or multi-layer kind of architecture over here. For a particular set of inputs, the output will be developed at this particular point. And the system is provided with the corresponding target value, a desired output. Desired output and the actual output is compared by means of this error calculation. So there could have been different error means. We can have least mean square error. We can have minimax times of error. So there are different types of error depending upon the problem under consideration, or depending upon the complexity that you can comply with. So different error calculation, different types of error calculation can be done over here. And this error signal is being fed back so as to adjust the weights, or sometimes the architecture, or in some other types, both the weights and the architectures as well. So that for a set of input, we find that the output developed from the neural network architecture and the target output becoming the same, so that the error is minimum and the weights are adjusted properly. So this is the notion of dynamic neural network. Although the idea is a little bit complex, because we have to do a lot of mathematical computation over here, unlike a static network. But the advantage is that if I use a dynamic neural network for an application, it can be adapted to the changes in the environment, and accordingly it can perform better under any situation. But it requires sufficient amount of time for the network to learn by itself. So this is all about the different types of architectures of a neural network. So if I want to summarize, so there are three different types of architectures in general. The first one is single-layered feed-forward architecture. Then we have the multi-layered feed-forward architecture and the recurrent architecture. As far as the organization of the neurons are concerned inside this neural network model. And apart from this, we could have a different types of a neural network, which is known to be the dynamic neural network, for which the weights are adapted always depending upon the value of the error signal. And we have also seen what is the use of having different types of architecture. Because as you change, or as you move from the single layer to the multi-layer, the complexity of the system becoming higher. But we have seen that a single neuron might not be able
to solve all types of problems in the world. So to start with, we have considered two different fundamental Boolean function three functions like AND, OR, and XOR. We have seen that for AND and OR, it is possible to realize using a single neuron. However, for XOR function, exclusive OR, and even for exclusive NOR operation, you will see that it is not at all possible to implement the same thing using a single neuron. So that's why we require the different types of architectures for our applications. So with this, I would like to conclude this lecture on architecture of neural network.